Hello everyone, I hope all of you are safe and well. On behalf of the AYUSH Center of Excellence, Interdisciplinary School of Health Sciences, Savitribai Phule, Pune University, Pune, I would like to welcome you all to the Saturday Club, a brainstorming meeting of research ideas. The Saturday Club is a meeting of an interdisciplinary group of researchers and is conducted on the first Saturday of every month to share experiences, ideas, and thoughts. During these meetings, we have a few structured scientific discussions with a flexible agenda and free time for interactions. Over the past few years, we have conducted around 40 such Saturday clubs. Today's talk is titled Beauty for a Scientist. As individuals, our perception of beauty differs from person to person. While some may find rock music beautiful, others may admire a symphony by an orchestra. This difference, or rather, our conventional definition of beauty may possibly be rooted in how our minds perceive beauty. It may also be that beauty is just a form of our curiosity. This may explain why there is beauty in Ramanujan's equations, or in how the mitochondria use actin tails to distribute equally between dividing cells. To discuss this extremely fascinating subject, we have with us Dr. Balasubramanian Nagaraj, Associate Professor from IISER Pune. Dr. Nagaraj is a cell biologist by training who pursued PhD in biochemistry from ACTREC Tata Memorial Center, Mumbai, and postdoc in mammalian phototransduction at the University of Miami, USA. He worked as a research assistant professor in the lab of Dr. Martin Schwartz at the University of Virginia, USA, and then moved to IISER Pune to start his lab in 2010 as an assistant professor and Ramalinga Swami Fellow. Dr. Nagaraj's research interests include understanding how cell adhesion regulates membrane trafficking, organelle function, and its implications in cell migration and anchorage dependence. Apart from science, Dr. Nagaraj is also interested in music, photography, art, movies, and books. He heads the University of Virginia chapter of SPICMAKE at IISER Pune. He was also instrumental in starting the IISER Pune movie club titled Kaleidoscope. We also have with us Professor Sharad Deshpande, who will be chairing this session. Professor Deshpande is the former head of the Department of Philosophy at Savitribai Phule, Pune University, a Tagore Fellow, and visiting professor at Indian Institute of Advanced Sciences, Shimla. Apart from being a philosopher, Professor Deshpande is also an amazing artist. Without further ado, I would now like to hand over this virtual platform to Dr. Nagaraj and request him to commence his talk. Dr. Nagaraj, the platform is all yours now.
Hi, Kalyani. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm going to share this presentation. Just give me a minute. Are you able to see this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Thanks for the kind introduction. Thanks also for this opportunity. I have a disclaimer at the beginning. This is more an exploration for me rather than a talk that I'm thinking is going to generate a lot of insight. Dr. Thiru as well, that these are merely thoughts that have happened over a period of time that I've tried to put together, and some of it may, if it sparked your imagination, lets you think a little further ahead, I think will be great, right? So I'm not in no way an expert to talk on art or art history or its connection to science. So this is more a curiosity talk, right? Something that has sprung from my exposure to art and science, which I've been a part of for many years. So a lot of this began, and I'm going to kind of try and walk you through some aspects of how we view art, or what our understanding of beauty in art is. a lot of this for me began in the time that I did my postdoc. I did my postdoc at the University of Virginia. And I was lucky to be about 2 hours from Washington, D.C., which had this really beautiful National Gallery of Art, which was free to anybody who wanted to come and access the gallery. And so in the first couple of years that I was there, I made it a point to go visit this gallery, you know, every 2 or 3 weeks. Had a chance to really experience some of the artwork, done by, great masters, like this one particular, piece that I'm putting up here, which is by Mane, along with others. For the first time, I was experiencing them, in person. And as much as these pieces, you've seen photographs of these, but to see them in real life, I think was incredibly inspiring. It was unlike any other experience that I have had, and it kept bringing me back. This is a painting by Turner, which is again one of their prized possessions. They have a few wonderful pieces by masters such as particular one. Particularly fond of, right? And so a lot of these paintings, this one is by Dega, gave me a chance to see and experience art in a way that I had I had not experienced before. It got me to reading about about what was written about beauty in many of these forms. And I remember going back to read one of the early books that I picked up to read, that I still remember, is this one written in 1896 by George Santayana, which is called The Sense of Beauty. So one of the things I'm hoping I will do is also kind of give you the opportunity to kind of explore some of these writings, so that you can go back and see if you can, get hold of some of these books. Many of them are available online as well. In that, he really talks about the sense of beauty there is within us as being a very radical and widespread tendency to observe beauty and to value it. And this is something that, we've all experienced in big and small ways. So the idea of what exactly could define beauty, there are many ways to look at it. And as you read more, among the things that drives our perception of beauty, I think is symmetry and pattern that, we are looking for or we are exposed to in different ways. A classic example of this is something that you must have all heard about, and there is a really nice book called The Golden Ratio by Gary Meisner that I will highly recommend. Mathematicians had suggested the presence of this golden ratio, which is symbolized by this Greek letter phi, which has a constant value of 1.618, and how a lot of the symmetry that exists in nature is driven by this golden ratio, including shells such as these snail shells that I'm sharing a picture here as well. This is also driven by the Fibonacci number sequence, which is related to the golden ratio in a way that the ratio of any two Fibonacci numbers is close to 1.618. The bigger the numbers get, the closer you get to this 1.618 ratio. And an elegant visualization of this Fibonacci number of sequences can be seen in this classic Fibonacci spiral, which is seen in many patterns in nature, including this shell that has been, of a snail that has been depicted here. Now, this symmetry or this ability to look at Fibonacci spiral in context of the art that has existed has been studied very extensively. Work particularly by Da Vinci, he's thought to use this ratio in many of the forms that he's described, and there are very great detailed studies on how these numbers and ratios play a very important role in determining the kind of symmetry that he's able to create in his artwork. There is, of course, all of this translating into active pieces of art. There is this very beautiful painting that I'm all familiar with in the Louvre, which is the Mona Lisa, and this has been extensively looked at, keeping in account or trying to keep in account the mathematics that has gone into creating these paintings. So does art actually, is it driven by extensively mathematics and the fact that symmetries that exist, which is why we find a piece like this beautiful, was an inherent question to have. There is a really interesting book on the math of Mona Lisa, which is written by Bulent Dacle, I will urge you to go look this up to kind of see a perspective of how he thinks mathematics is incorporated into this one particular artwork. Though there are, I have to say that not everybody agrees with him. There is a very interesting review of the book by Alan Shapiro, where he says that despite the presence of mathematics in some aspects of artistic works, humanists and probably most scientists will not be convinced that mathematics is an essential feature of art. Whatever the true nature of art may be, mathematics appears to be only incidental to it, both as a means of analysis and as a tool. So there are clearly differences in opinion here in terms of whether the art that that we see and the beauty that we are able to appreciate is driven by any of this. Now, this kind of ability to sense or appreciate a pattern, I think, is not restricted to the beauty that you see in art. It's obviously inherent in music as well, right? And my way of illustrating the kind of pattern or patterning that exists in music, I think, is using two pieces that actually lack this pattern. Okay, and we have all heard wonderful pieces of music that you can appreciate for long periods of time, understanding the pattern that exists in them. The first piece is actually something that was composed by Igor Stravinsky in 1913, and it's called The Rite of Spring. Okay, and it was premiered in a theater in Paris in 1913, and there is this famous story of how the theater, a lot of people essentially, there was a riot in the theater, to put it mildly. That's how the press sold it the next day, and people were extremely disturbed by the fact that this ballet was performed the way it was, and particularly the music that was part of this ballet. And this led to people being very disturbed and upset by it, almost leading to a riot in the theater, which is again contested. It depends on whom you're asking. So this piece I'm going to play a little bit for you, okay, to kind of give you a flavor of what the audience must have heard. And this is this piece in the Rite of Spring called The Sacrificial Dance. A lot of this is available online. You should go check it out if you would be interested. I'm going to play a small piece to kind of give you a sense of what exactly seemed disconnect in this particular piece of music, and you be the judge of this, right? Clearly, this was 1913, and you have to consider the fact that the kind of music that people were exposed to at that point of time, there was nothing that was written that seemed to mimic what he did on that particular day, right? So let's listen to some of this.
Thank you.
So that was a piece from The Rite of Spring. And the second piece of music, and this really set the stage for Igor Stravinsky to be recognized and really had a huge impact on music that was written since, written by him and others. I don't know how you react to this particular piece at this particular point of time, but there was a very strong reaction to the piece when it was made in 1930. There is another piece of music that I've chosen, which is by this very famous jazz musician called John Coltrane. John Coltrane released an album called The Love Supreme, which in 1964, it is still considered one of his great works. But at that time, there was nobody was doing music. None of the jazz masters were playing anything that that looked remotely like what he had composed at that point of time. It's now considered a masterpiece, but one of the challenges at that point, for many who are listening to jazz, is jazz had a certain tempo architecture to it, and this tried to undo some of that, right? And the reason I bring both these pieces up is because of the kind of challenge they throw at our expectation for a certain pattern or rhythm, which could be vital to how we understand a piece of art or a piece of music. So I'm going to play a small bit of this opening for Love Supreme, and this is a piece called The Awakening. So that was the piece that I wanted you to hear a bit of. And at the end, maybe I will ask what your reaction to these pieces of music were. But they clearly created quite a bit of excitement and storm in the music community at the time that they were released. And these are at a very different period of time. The idea of picking these two pieces of music was also to illustrate how our sense of symmetry or pattern can be challenged, right? And the importance that that has in our perception of beauty, whether that be in a piece of art or in a piece of music. Nothing that we can say about beauty makes sense except in the light of how we perceive it, which is how our brain perceives this sense of beauty. So there is a fair bit of understanding now on whether there are regions in the brain that specifically can respond to our ability to perceive or understand beauty. There has been this lookout for a beauty center in the brain. And I'll tell you later on, some very recent work that has challenged some of these perceptions, right? So there is this idea that there are very specific regions in the brain, the orbitofrontal complex, ventromedial prefrontal cortex, which could be sites where, or which are contributing to how we understand and perceive, how the brain understands and perceives beauty, right? So there, so the role of the brain obviously is clearly vital. And there is a very beautiful quote from David Hume, that philosopher, which suggests, where he says that making the argument for beauty, that beauty is no quality in things themselves. It exists merely in the mind which contemplates them. And each mind contemplates a different beauty, right? So our perception of beauty, can it entirely be defined by the biology of the brain, is clearly an open question. Right? How much of that perception is and that reflect, why some things appeal to some people and not to the others, and vice versa. Everything that we say about the brain in the context of beauty, I think, and this ability to see beauty in different ways, I think for me is epitomized in the work of Marc Chagall. So Chagall is this 19th century Russian painter. My wife is a very ardent fan of Chagall. So we went and saw a lot of his paintings, whenever we got an opportunity to do so. For her, they are the happiest paintings there is, right? And for me, they evoked absolutely no response, right? Like I could stand in front of a Chagall, for an hour and not feel much, right? And for her, the idea of being in front of this painting, looking at it, dramatically filled her with joy in a way that I could not experience at all, right? And this was very striking for me because one, I knew it wasn't fake. She genuinely felt what she was feeling. It surprised me that I didn't feel the same way, right, about these paintings. I'm curious how many of you look at a Chagall, these are two of his works, react one way or the other. There are artists where this distinction is very prominent. And on a personal level, for me, that was very strongly illustrated in Chagall's work. And this kind of goes back to what Hume was saying earlier, that this perception could vary depending upon individuals and what exactly then defines this, right? None of this can be viewed nothing in biology can, except in the context of or in the light of evolution, right? So evolutionarily, our ability to perceive beauty, to be able to like and dislike, are there genuine advantages, to this? And clearly there is a lot of work that has gone into this, and I'm going to kind of catch one aspect of this in a review that was published in 2011, which essentially focuses on our ability to see beauty in faces. And clearly this is there are strong evolutionary advantages to this. And I'm kind of picking a few lines from that review, which kind of captures what the review is trying to say. This picture that you see here is again, a very beautiful painting by Vermeer, called The Girl with the Pearl Earring. The review itself talks about beauty is not just as beauty is not just being a simple social construct. Attractiveness is integrated in our biology. While some aspects of face perception might be innate, other aspects are clearly influenced by experience. Individual difference in preferences for some traits will prove adaptive and so are consistent with evolutionary theory. Right. So as I was putting this slide together, I picked this and I had another slide listing at some of these aspects that the review is talking about. And I asked my wife to pick an image for that slide, as something that for her defines beauty. And this is what she chose. So the next slide is thanks to her. But the point that the article is making is that among the things that drive this attractiveness includes, symmetry, the averageness of faces, secondary sexual characteristics in faces, skin health and color, facial cues associated with personality attribution, and internal factors and context and exposure that could all drive, how we perceive, a face. Now, one of the questions that I've had for a very long time is whether our ability to perceive or to see beauty in faces is overlapping in the brain with our ability to see beauty in other pieces of art, for example, right? And are they the same thing? And are we really, when we look at a Rembrandt and admire it, are we really looking at, are we tapping into this, evolutionarily resident trait in us? And there is an article published this year, which actually addresses this, and I'll come to it in the next slide or two, right? So this, obviously, this trait is very strong, and this ability to, and has been, is exploited in many ways. There are two faces I'm showing you here, the interesting about these thing about these two faces is one is of a real person, and one is artificially generated, AI generated, and you can't tell the difference unless I tell you which one is which, right? We've now got to this point where AI is able to generate faces mimicking characteristics, properties that are appealing to to consumers or people, and this has many uses in advertising and other things, right? And another example of this that I am particularly fond of is how it reflects in design, right? And the Mini Cooper is a good example of this. And this is taken from the BMW site, how they describe. But I remember reading about the fact that when the design for the Cooper was made, among the traits that they wanted to really incorporate in that design is for a person looking at it, looking at the car, to react like they would react to another person, right? And this changes how we perceive something. So our ability, which is ingrained, in all of us, can be used, exploited, if you want to call it that, in such ways as well. Which brings me back to this, thought of nothing in beauty makes sense except in light of the brain. And I'm going to give you another example of how to think about this. And this comes from the work of a remarkable French artist, Paul Cézanne, who did some very interesting work that if you ever get a chance, to see one of his pieces of art, you should spend a fair bit of time trying to stand and observe a Cézanne painting, because Cézanne did a lot of still life. And there is a quote from him which says that the eye must grasp, bring things together, and then the brain has to give it shape. And I remember reading how it used to take a significant amount of time for Cézanne to put one particular stroke, in one of his works. And everything was very carefully measured with his, you know, where he was really trying to capture something that you will see in the painting that actually goes beyond what's on the painting, right? And if you spend time looking at some of Cezanne's work, you can actually sense this, things that don't actually are not in the painting become visible after a period of time, you see things in ways that you would not have otherwise. And this is truly something to experience in my opinion. So Cezanne did a lot of interesting work. There is a very interesting book that I'm going to direct you towards, which is written by John Lehrer, which is called Proust Was a Neuroscientist. And he talks about how Cezanne's work, also told us how our minds perceive, art or beauty. So Lehrer says of the paintings of Paul Cezanne, instead of giving us a sense of full realized forms, Cezanne supplies us with layers of suggestive edges out of which forms slowly unfurl. Our vision is made of lines, and Cezanne has made the lines distressingly visible. In other words, Cezanne got the eye right long before Hubel and Wiesel transformed our understanding of the visual cortex that exists in the brain. So he was able to understand and put something in his painting that led him to think that given the time, the viewer will be able to see something in his work that goes beyond anything that he can actually capture on a canvas, right? And Cezanne went a step ahead, and later on in life, there were many paintings that he did, which had significant portions of the painting of the canvas essentially left blank, right? This is one such work by Cezanne where he was essentially asking you and your brain to fill the gaps. Okay, and see whether you're able to see what he was trying to capture. Okay, there's one more piece that illustrates what Cezanne was trying to do. So it's very interesting how artists have tried to use how our brain thinks and perceives art to drive their art to places that they could not have. And in all fairness, a lot of this experimentation that Cezanne did happened much later in life when he was a bit more established and had a chance to kind of explore, his understanding of how we perceive art and beauty. Which brings me, which brings me to this really interesting study that was published, in 2020. Which for the first time, and this got a lot of press and you might have heard about it as well, looked at the beauty center in the brain and used, activation likelihood estimation, ALE meta-analysis of fMRI studies to determine whether what part of the brain is activated when we are looking at a visual art versus when we are looking at a face. Right, and what they found striking, that was striking in this study, is that these centers are distinctly different in the brain, right? And there is more work that's happening, but it clearly seemed to suggest that the way we perceive faces and beauty in faces could be very distinctly different from how we perceive a painting, for that matter of fact. So this idea that to overlap, right? And that's the reason evolutionarily we are, there are merits to being able to look at faces and be able to distinguish, characteristics there. That does not necessarily translate into how we look at visual art. Is this true for other animals? Are we unique in this sense? Are all open questions at this point of time. But this was very interesting observation that was made last year. And I will leave you with this one particular image, which is a very beautiful work of art that you should go check out by Greg Dunn and Edwards, which is called Self-Reflected. And it essentially uses a very interesting micro etching technique to look at the brain of a real person using MRI images and map the kind of neurons and axons that exist. As this kind of line summarizes it, it's basically an animated painting of your brain perceiving itself as an animated painting, right? So the brain is doing a lot here in terms of our understanding or appreciation of art per se. Which brings me to this last part, right? This stems from everything that's happened over the last year and a half. We've all been dealing with this pandemic and what that has done to all of our lives. I think things have, many people have lost year and years, and many of us have had to stay at home and kind of spend time at home and do things differently. Kids are stuck at home. I have an 8-year-old son who spent a good part of the last year at home, right? And luckily for us, we are on a campus which makes our life a little bit easier. But in this period, that he was home and, we had to find things to do and interesting, keep him, occupied. We end up doing something interesting that stemmed from this primary observation. Okay, this is a moth that really caught our attention because of the sheer, spectacular view of it, right? And my son, I remember pointing this out and noticing every little thing about how beautiful this this species of moth was. And this led him to now start looking at all the other moths that we were seeing in and around. And this became a thing we did for the last 11 or 12 months. A lot of these pictures were taken on the phone, on walks. But I started noticing, these things too on campus. And we put everything together. So the next slide that you see, kind of a summation of some of these observations that we made. Thanks to tools like iNaturalist, you can go identify many of these species. But we saw all of this on campus in a matter of about a few months, about 6 months or so, right? And in part, almost every time, the thing that caught our attention is the sheer beauty of this, right? Of each of these remarkable creatures. But the question that this led to also in my mind is this idea of, what exactly that beauty means, right? Obviously we were, what caught our attention with this moth, was the patterns, was everything that we saw that made it as attractive and beautiful as it is. What it drove is a sense of curiosity to kind of figure out, whether there were other moths like this. Did we see, how many did we see in a matter of a few weeks? All that curiosity that led to, the images I showed you just now, stemmed from this beauty, which led me to kind of this question that I think others have asked as well, which is beauty a particularly potent and intense form of curiosity? Okay, a learning signal urging us to keep on paying attention, an emotional reminder that there's something here worth figuring out. And is that what drives, this sense of beauty that we notice in everything, be it, the work of Monet or Mane, or the moths on IISER campus, right? Which then brings me to how I, as a scientist, view beauty as well. My lab is the cell adhesion lab at IISER, and we study how cells stick to things. you know, inherently originate from this sense of curiosity that maybe all of us have, and some of us, you know, are able to pursue as well. So we study how things move around in cells, and we study this complex that is listed in green here called the Golgi complex, right? And the Golgi complex exists like a stack in cells. And you know, if you look at a cell that is adherent, the complex is really nicely packed, and that's what it looks like, right? But a few years ago, we discovered how if you take a cell that is adherent and that is stuck to things, right? This Golgi that is nicely compacted and packed, you know, opens up to fill the entire cell. So the red and green that you see on the left are two marker proteins that label the Golgi. And if you detach the cell, you know, this opens up, you know, to fill the entire cell. And so that's, those two same markers now are distributed very differently, you know, in the cell. I take this and I put it back on and make the cell adherent again. I ask it to stick, and very quickly, all of this stuff that has opened up, you know, goes and becomes a nice compact structure again. Okay, I detach this cell, it will go back to being opened up. I can keep doing this all day, and the cell will do this, right? And we figured out the mechanism by which this is happening and what the process is, which is, you know, which is the science of it. But for me, the beauty of this, you know, is twofold. One is, of course, there is this visual element to what you're seeing, right? And these are images of a real cell, you know, taken using a special confocal microscope, and then we do image processing to allow you to see these beautiful images. But there is beauty in this thought as well, right? Because, you know, these are cells that we've worked with, I worked with, you know, for a significant part of my academic life. I, you know, to think that cells have been doing this, you know, for, I don't know, maybe thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of years. The fact that you detach some of these cells and they can open up and can go back to being compact again, is an incredibly beautiful thought for me as a scientist, right? Now, does this arise from the same curiosity that led us to go looking for moths? And is that the same curiosity that, you know, took me to Washington, D.C. every 2 weeks to look at the paintings that I managed to see? This is an open question for me. I don't have an answer, you know, and I'm going to end with this question you know, open the floor for comments and discussions and leave the slide up. Okay, so that's my, you know, that's my pitch on this idea. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for an interesting talk and an interesting discussion on how our brains perceive beauty. I'm sure the audience has enjoyed it. We have with us Dr. Ashok Vaidya, a physician scientist whose interests range from Holy Gita to Hollywood. I would like to request him to kindly offer us brief comments on this topic.
I enjoyed the lecture. Congratulations. I have raised some question in the chat box. I see Sharad Deshpande also, and I would love to have his comments. I did not see a single art piece of Indian art, sculpture, architecture, not one even of any Oriental besides India also. Sure. And as a clinical neuroscientist also, and collaborator of Professor Vidita Vaidya, I always take cudgels about Indian knowledge systems being totally almost neglected by our anglicized scientists. But I enjoyed, it was a feast of eyes, because many years back I gave a commencement address at St. G.S. Medical College where I covered all these paintings and sculptures, but I included Indian also. Why? My question is that Aurobindo has written a wonderful 4 chapters on art. Mm-hmm. And in these 4 chapters, I would like Sharad probably has read it. Maybe our neuroscientists don't look at Aurobindo, but it is worthwhile looking at him because he was one of the India's great Renaissance men. And he said that the Western art and Indian art, or Oriental art and Occidental art, they had a lot of difference in terms of Occidental art trying to be very close to nature in terms of proportions, in terms of representations. Only recently it is moving away after Picasso and modern art and other forms modern art appeared. And he has explained this, and that's why my question is, if you can read Dr. Nagaraj in the chat box, I would like you to respond, because I believe that there is a lot to learn from Indian aesthetics also.
Absolutely. Because
shastras which are devoted to aesthetics. And what I loved most was your finding moths on IISER. And I think these moths are amazing creatures. And Vidita's daughter, Alina, gets very scared of moths. And I don't know why. I think she should see your pictures and she will get enthralled that what wonderful moths exist. But basically, what you have put before us, that science has beauty. But whether beauty needs science and how much is a question. Because all our neural correlates are currently related to consciousness, as we understand consciousness as a function of brain. Data are emerging, and in India, we don't need even data. We have living examples of people who consciousness extends beyond their brain. And then Indian art would be probably hinting towards that. So I would request Dr. Nagaraj to just respond to some of these questions. Thank you. Wonderful lecture. Wonderful lecture.
Thank you. Thank you. No, your criticism is well taken. I think, you know, it's one of those, the idea of not being able to bring, Indian art and even Indian sculpture. And, there are, just as Da Vinci had, clear indications of how to plan, a structure, I think there is a lot of that in Indian, temple architecture, particularly. As I said, I this was more based on my journey, during this period of time. I am reading too, so I'm with you on this, I also am curious to understand how, what is known about this in the Indian context. And it's not for not appreciating the fact that it is there here. I think Dr. Deshpande might be able to, comment more on the on Sri Aurobindo's extensive writings on this. I am just beginning to read him, right? And I haven't, it's one of those things that I want to also explore, because I know, as you rightly said, he has written about art and the mind. Your second question on the closeness to nature in the Occidental art form versus the Oriental art, trying to transcend it, will have to be debated in views of consciousness beyond the brain. I completely agree with you. Clearly, these are more, this isn't a scholarly talk in any sense. I think it was, these are largely musings, of a scientist who, has experienced some of this, and it's coming from a very personal perspective, right? So thank you so much for your comments, sir. Right? Dr. Deshpande, would you like to add or respond to Dr.
Yes, Rangia? Yes. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Ashok sir, am I audible to you?
Much audible.
Okay. Nice to see you after a long time. Nice to see you after a long time. And sometimes Bhushan and myself, we keep on talking about you. Okay. Okay, with this, I want to make many comments, not just one or two. The first comment, and I'm very, I will not mince words, but I'll be very forthright. My first comment, and it is for the organizers, that a brainstorming session should not become a brain jamming session. You see this? A brainstorming session should not become a brain jamming session, in the sense that that since now I can see in this chat box, in this thing, some around 100 persons are attending this. So means there are 100 brains which are waiting for a storming session. So they must get some time. That's one thing. So the speaker must give just 3 to 4 ideas, throw them open for discussion or for brainstorming. That is one. Number two. Now I entirely agree with Dr. Vaidya that when in India we talk about beauty, or when we talk about anything like, you know, I mean, so let us concentrate on beauty. When we are talking about beauty and other things, we, I mean, it's so sad that we modern Indians, and especially I am very sorry. Hello? Am I audible? Hello?
Very audible, very audible.
No, something happens to my screen, so I am unable to, I mean, it unsettles me. But anyway, so the point is that there is such a wealth of knowledge and shastras and writings. And we modern Indians, we simply are not aware of all these things. And then we just, and this is not, you know, even in my own discipline called philosophy, a large number of teachers and students, they are after Sartre and Russell and all the European philosophers, Kant and Nietzsche and so on, but they are hardly know anything about Indian philosophers like Gautama and Sankhya and all these systems and so on and so forth. That is one thing. But I don't want to make an issue out of that. Today's presentation, and I will speak from a definite point of view. That is, I will take a position and then I will argue. So my first, my position is this, that experience of beauty and theorizing over the experience of beauty are to be kept aside, number one. Now, experience of beauty is something which is common to every human being, whether he is a scientist, whether he is a philosopher, whether he is a common man and whatnot. So experience of beauty is something which is very human, which is very basic, and which is very unique to the experiencing apparatus of human being. That is one. Now, therefore, to say that how a scientist looks at beauty, or how a philosopher looks at beauty, or how, for example, and say a commerce man looks at beauty, these, I think, are misplaced questions, because as human beings, they are experiencing beauty, maybe in a rose flower, maybe in a sunset, maybe in a work of art like painting, maybe in a piece of music, and so on and so forth. So the point is that human beings have a capacity to experience what we call beauty, either in nature or in man-made objects or man-made artifacts. Now, this should be our starting point. Now comes the problem of theorizing. Now, there have been many theories that seek to explain the experience of beauty. And then, and some of these things the speaker today has touched upon. And there comes the point of the norms of beauty. And then there was a talk about symmetry, contrast, balance, proportion, so on and so forth. Now my next submission is that in theorizing, we require these norms. But in actual experience of beauty, these norms, they perform a very limited role. That is to say that suppose we come across a picture or a painting which fulfills all these criteria or which fulfills all these norms. For instance, there is a symmetry, there is a proportion, there is a contrast, there is balance. All these norms are present in a work of art, but still one may not feel it to be beautiful. That happens. That is the part, that is the beauty of this experience. That is, these norms, even though they are present, they do not ensure that the experiencer will feel beauty in that work of art. That is one thing. So we need to really see the limitations of this theory, which says that there are norms of beauty, and if the norms of beauty are there, or if the norms are followed, then the object will turn out to be beautiful. That does not happen. Now this takes us to that quotation which Dr. Nagaraj showed us, the quotation from David Hume, who says that beauty is in everybody's mind, implying that beauty is something which is subjective. That is, what I will find beautiful, you may not find, or what we Indians might find beautiful, an African may not find it beautiful. And this happens. The question is, why this happens? Why this subjectivity of experience of beauty? This subjectivity is not, this subjectivity is to a large extent determined by the culture to which you and I belong. That is to say, an African, he will not appreciate, in high probability, an African, unless he is trained, but an African will not be able to appreciate the beauty of Bhimsen Joshi's singing. And I may not be able to appreciate the beauty of some African jazz, of African drum player or something like that. So the point is that our appreciation of beauty or our experience of beauty, as long as man-made artifacts are concerned, like music, painting, dance, and so on, they are largely determined by the culture. And so here comes the role of culture. Here comes the role of the entire, I would now widen the meaning of the term culture. I will say, here comes the role of, hello?
Yes, sir,
you are audible.
Okay. So here comes the role of culture, and I will now expand the meaning of the term culture. Culture to me is a certain way of life, in which an individual relates himself or herself to the entire cosmos, to the entire universe. Now this form, I call it a Jivana Drushti. Now this Jivana Drushti is the basis of the experience of our beauty. And in that Jivana Drushti, at one level, need not be the same everywhere. An African man's, or say the ancient Egyptian culture or man's, their Jivana Drushti need not be the same as the Jivana Drushti of Indians. But at another level, at a still higher level, as a human being, our Jivana Drushti, the Jivana Drushti of an Indian, of an African, and so on, Chinese and so on, it is just one and the same. So how does beauty operate at these different levels? That is to say, at the level where all these distinctions between an African and an Indian withers away, or at the level at which these distinctions, that is the African and the Indian, are very much real, and still at a lower level where the distinction between you and me are concerned. So beauty, the talk of beauty, operates at all these three different levels, and we should not mix up these issues. That is number one. That is my point number one. My second point is that, and here I will take a little time in in sharing with you my one of my very an experience from 30, 40 years ago. In Pune, we had a very distinguished scholar. He is now no more. His name was Mr. Prabhakar Padhye. He was a very distinguished person, and he was the general secretary of, in those days, in this Cold War period, there used to be this American, you know, establishment called Freedom for Cultural something something. And he was the director or general secretary of entire Asian region. Now, this this Mr. Padhye, he was a very senior to me, but was a very good friend of mine. He wrote a book, and he was greatly influenced by psychological theories in psychology in those days. So he wrote a book, and he called me, and he gave that book to me for reading and my comments. And after those comments, he was to publish it. I read that book, and in which he had argued a theory which he called three brain theory. And he said that normally when we talk about our experiences, emotion and thought, so we have these are apportioned to two brains, the bigger and the smaller. But he said to explain the aesthetic experience, we need to posit another brain which he called third brain. And then he tried to locate it somewhere in the cortex or whatever. So I read that book, and then I went to him and I said that I don't agree with you at all. And this doesn't explain a bit about the beauty of, about the experience of beauty. And I had a very long argument with him. The point that I wanted to make then, and even now in today's presentation, is this, that any amount of attempt to explain three types of experiences. One, the religious experience, the aesthetic experience, where we talk about beauty, the religious experience when we talk about the divine, the aesthetic experience when we talk about beauty, and the moral experience, where we want to talk about the good, bad, the sense of good and bad, right and wrong. Now, these three realms and the experiences in these three realms cannot be explained in terms of finding out the brain waves and this and that and so on and so forth. No scientist will ever be successful in explaining these three types of experiences in terms of brain functioning. You see, there was a reference that certain specific points in brain are the receptors of beauty experiences, etc. Suppose you tell me this, and then I'll say, so what? So what? You have told me the functioning of the brain. So my question will still stand, so what? That doesn't help me in understanding the experience of beauty at all. That's one thing. So this is my standpoint. I mean, I'm arguing from this standpoint to all the scientists, scientific community on this issue. Number three, therefore, when we talk about beauty, what happens or what is happening is that we are using a certain language, or we are using a certain language game to talk about beauty by using various cognate terms. And so in order to know what is beauty, we must learn to use this particular language game in which we talk about beauty. This is the third point that I want to make. So with these three points, I think I have summarized the talk, and I entirely agree with Dr. Vaidya that this talk was very, 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 very beautiful talk, I should say, very good, very thought-provoking talk. It provoked me to come out with these sharp reactions is the success of the talk, I should say. And this is the kind of thing that there are many issues. I think I have in my chat box, I have written that this lecture raises so many points or so many issues which need to be dealt with separately and with very great care. That is the point. Now, therefore, I would just make one point. Now look at Tagore. I was a Tagore fellow, so I read a bit of Tagore. And you know, that entire generation, Tagore, then Kumaraswamy, Ananda Kumaraswamy. Now he says that Asian and the European and Asian, particularly in understanding of art, is radically different. And then there is a lot of sustained arguments. And I wish that science, that doctor, a person like Dr. Nagaraj must read these things first than reading David Hume or whosoever he wants to read. That's that. I mean, I'm sorry, I'm not a nationalist in this narrow sense of the term. I'm not. But I am very firm on this point that there is such a great amount of intellectual work and intellectual efforts have been made by these people like Ananda Kumar. Now, Kumaraswamy was a Ceylonese, by the way. He was not an Indian. He was a born Ceylonese from Ceylon. Now, this man says that Indian and Western understanding of art is radically different. And he gives, and it's not, and he also was not talking about any from the nationalist perspective. He was talking about from a very highly intellectual point of view. So coming to this, and now look at the paintings. Now, what is the difference between paintings that were shown? Incidentally, I am also an artist. I do paint. And I have spent a lot of time visiting these art galleries in Paris. I was offered a fellowship, and the fellowship was that I can visit all art galleries in Paris, like Louvre and Musée d'Orsay and so on, any number of times, any number of days throughout the period of my fellowship. And my fellowship was just to do the very, you know, intense study of the paintings, European paintings. So I'm aware of that. Now my point is that what's the difference between these paintings, whether we are talking about the pre-Renaissance and the post-Renaissance and paintings in European art traditions and Indian paintings. How do we appreciate the beauty of Ajanta paintings? What norms do we have? Now we have to, or do we have different kind of norms when we go to Paris? We have different type of norms when we go to New York, when we have different types of norms when we go to Ajanta. We have to reflect on these, and these kinds of questions will give us some understanding towards knowing what is beauty and how do we experience it. That's the point. So I think that's what I wanted to say. And thank you for, Girish, I should thank you for inviting me to this brainstorming session. Thank you.
You have indeed stormed our brains. And I think Nagaraj excited you, me, everybody. His purpose is served. And I see next Nagaraj and Vidhi and neuroscientist of India trying to understand the frescoes of Ajanta and Ellora sculptures. And I remember one fresco of Ajanta where Buddha is going to his palace to beg from Yashodhara and Rahul. And Buddha is shown as a huge tall figure, and at the right hand corner at the bottom is Yashodhara with a small Rahul. Now in sense of proportionality, the Western would say that this is just tribal kind of representation. And such comments have been made on Indian art. And that's why Aurobindo also cites like Sharad Kumaraswamy. So what I feel is, and myself, Girish, Sharad, Bhushan, all of us are trying against odds, and we all have tremendous background in Western education, Western science, technology, but we are trying our best to see the Indian knowledge systems should have their rightful place, and particularly in neurosciences, because the brain frontier is the greatest last frontier. And what Sharad beautifully said about three brains or three minds or whatever you have to say. But I think that all the research being done on consciousness outside brain are being done in US and not in India. I think even Mukherjee did some work, but most of them visit India to recall and understand past birth memory. And I think that there is time, and I would say Girish should organize a meeting in terms of, because this is an Ayurvedic center which has invited you. And Girish, very important part is, just now we are only concentrating Yukti Vyaparshay. I had to address the California Association of Ayurvedic Medicine. That time I said, only Yukti Vyaparshay of Ayurveda is being used. What we call Sattvavajay and Deva Vyaparshay are hardly being touched upon. And I think that brainstorming indeed is needed on Sattvavajay. And Sattva is rightly, Sharad said, we should not confuse the levels. Because what happens, even in biological organization, at molecular and cellular level, and at organ and system level, and the whole, that's why system biology had to be evolved. But that is floundering. So what matters is that we must keep our philosophers in our mind while we get busy with our reductionist science. Wonderful disposition, Sharad. Wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Nagaraj, do you wish to say something?
No. Fantastic. I just the opportunity to get to listen to Dr. Vaidya and Dr. Deshpande. I think the idea was, as you rightly said, to get this thought going, and clearly there is so much to be understood. This question of curiosity for me as being the basis of how we perceive beauty is again something that I don't know whether there is anything written in any of your readings that that allude to this. And so I'm just curious.
It's a very good point you are raising. Ultimately, the reality is described as Sat, Chit and Anand. See, Sat, Chit and Anand means Satyam, Shivam, Sundaram. So when our jignasa is your curiosity. So when he says Athato Brahma Jignasa, that is then Athato Satya Jignasa, Athato Shiva Jignasa, and also Athato Sundarya Jignasa. So I totally agree with you that this is what is curbed in our schools right from the outset. And I had to give an oration at Gujarat Vidyapeeth. That's why I mentioned that we are just loading our kids with information and completely curbing their imagination and curiosity. And I'm so proud that your son got excited by it. And I was just telling Alina that I would like to, you please send it to Vidita, your collection of this moth picture, because then she will also stop getting afraid of moths.
will do, sir.
Thank you for this wonderful session, Dr. Nagaraj. Actually, we were thinking about it for a long time, and there are many responses in chat box that we should have series of discussions on this very important topic. Many times we get locked in very specific activities in our labs or in our projects, but there are a lot many things that we need to really discuss, and this was one of the very fascinating and wonderful session. Thank you very much for all your time and efforts to put many things together, and we'll continue this interaction. We thank Vaidya sir for his time and words of wisdom. The truth, good and beauty, they are not very different. Satyam Shivam Sundaram, as you said, sir. Thank you very much. And this problem, when we actually discuss many times in, especially Ayurveda research, I mean Ayurveda researchers, many times we get trapped in very narrow questions, evidence, p-values, something is better than another thing. But the inherent questions is not about doubts, but are about curiosity. Jidnyasa, that is jnatum iccha, the urge to know something, that is very important than the momentary questions about evidence. So thank you very much, Vaidya sir, for this light. We are thankful to Sharad Deshpande sir for his profound words. Many of us, we are actually doctors of philosophy without understanding anything of philosophy. And hence, we make a point that there should be, again, a continuous interaction and interchange, exchange between biomedical disciplines and humanities. That is the need of the hour. Thank you, Deshpande sir, for your profound words. And thank you, all the audience, that we are really concluding this session with many more questions and a very wonderful journey what Dr. Nagaraj really painted with many of the paintings and music and his pictures of his lab work. Thank you very much. Once again, we thank the Center for Publication Ethics for providing us this particular facility. Thank you, Dr. Shubhada Nagarkar and colleagues. Thank you very much.
Thank you.